Apple has just released Swift 6.1, which is available in the latest version of Xcode. So let's go over some of its new features to see what's new and what's the impact for iOS developers. So first, we have an improvement over the syntax used to write concurrent code with the possibility to mark an entire type or an entire extension as non-isolated. It was already possible to mark a specific property or a specific function or method as non-isolated, but now this new possibility lets you mark it in bulk, we could say. And it's kind of interesting to see this change being introduced because the way I understand it, this possibility of marking a big part of the code as non-isolated, well, it's kind of a way to bypass the warnings and the errors that you have to deal with when you migrate your code to Swift 6. So it's kind of interesting to see Apple introduce this kind of like sugar syntax here to try and make things a little bit easier to do. To be fully honest, I'm very curious to see what will be the messaging of Apple around this migration to Swift 6 at WWDC this year. Because last year, their messaging was really clear. Apps had to migrate. They could do it step by step, package by package, but they had to migrate. I am really curious to see, well, how this messaging was met by the reality of the amount of work that it involves. And I'm curious to see what Apple will say, whether they will change their messaging a bit, whether they will introduce some tooling to make the migration a bit easier. To be fully transparent with you, I haven't dug that much on that topic, in part because what I'm seeing kind of makes me think that maybe there will be changes in a couple of months. And so I'm kind of waiting to see what's going to happen before I invest more time and energy on this topic. Still on the topic of code that uses Swift concurrency, there is another nice improvement completely unrelated to the migration to Swift 6 this time. It's an improvement to the way Swift concurrency can leverage type inference. So I'm sure that the first time that you created a task group, you noticed that you had to explicitly provide the type of what the tasks of the group would return. And I'm sure it felt kind of weird because in Swift, we are very much used to the compiler being able to infer it for us. However, in this case, it wasn't possible. My understanding of why you had to specify the type in this case is because the closure that you pass to the function with task group is much more complex than the one you would pass to a function like map, and the compiler wasn't able to extract the type from this more complex closure. However, it seems that it's no longer the case because now, since Swift 6.1, the compiler is able to infer the type even in this more complex case, and so you no longer need to repeat yourself and explicitly provide a type when calling the function with task group, which is quite a nice addition. Not a big change for experienced developers, but I can imagine that for people who are new to Swift and discovering Swift concurrency, it removes a potential source of friction. The next new feature is one that honestly surprised me quite a bit, and it's the possibility to provide a Swift implementation for a declaration that has been imported from Objective-C. And the reason why I've been surprised is because it's been now more than 10 years since Swift has been introduced. And so I would have expected such a new feature to be introduced in the early years of Swift, when Swift still needed to convince people to migrate away from Objective-C, but not 10 years after the fact. So it kind of got me curious, and I went to look at the Swift evolution proposal, and I saw that the author of that proposal was an Apple engineer working on the Swift compiler. And that makes me think that Apple might be in the process of migrating part of their very large Objective-C codebase to Swift, and maybe they needed this specific feature for this migration to happen step by step, and that's why they added it to Swift. Of course, this is just a hypothesis. I have absolutely no idea whether that's true or not. The next improvement is a small one, but one that I'm particularly happy about, and it's an addition in the number of places where we're allowed to use a trailing comma. So what's a trailing comma? It's when you're defining a list of values and you're still allowed to put a comma after the last value, even though there is no next value after it. This was already supported when defining a collection. So in collection literals, here we have an example with an array literal. And this is super useful in two situations. First, when you're doing code generation, because it saves you from having to handle the extra logic of is it the last element or not. And also, it helps getting more meaningful results when using the git author, or formerly known as git blame, command, because it will not show the person that just added this comma as the last author for the line. And usually, this information is not super useful because the person that just added a comma probably had nothing to do with the person that actually added the value to the collection. And in Swift 6.1, we are now allowed to use this trailing comma syntax with tuples, parameters, argument list, generic parameter list, closure capture list, and string interpolation. So honestly, that seems to describe all of the places where you can pass several values. And here you have the example of a trailing comma being added after the last argument of a method call. So honestly, as I was saying, I'm a big fan of this syntax. So I would definitely recommend that you use it if you already use the convention of splitting literal declarations and function calls over several lines. And I'm sure that linters and code formatters will very soon, if it's not already the case, add rules so that this syntax can be enforced automatically. Next, we have a very interesting feature, which is the ability to declare traits that can be used to have an impact over how a package will be built. So I really liked this kind of new features because such new features is going to be either you will not use them and they will not have any impact on your workflow whatsoever, or you have a use case for them and they will have a big, big impact on your workflow. They might simplify a lot of your code. So it's really one of these situations where it's everything or nothing. But I'm especially thinking of SDK developers where sometimes you have to offer different configurations. Here they show the example of a version of a package for embedded Swift where you don't have all of the APIs available, but it could also be different version of a package depending on whether you run on the simulator or on a real device, for example. So if you're an SDK developer, I'm sure you'll want to take a closer look at this feature because it seems like it could have the potential to save you quite a lot of time and energy. Up next, we have a new feature for Swift testing, and it's the ability to implement traits that can then be added to a test and that allow you to implement a setup or a teardown logic. So it's interesting to see this new feature because back when Swift testing was announced 1 year ago, the best practice that was shared was that if you needed some setup logic, you should implement it in the init of the type that encompasses your test. And if you needed some teardown logic, then you should make that type a class and implement the logic in the dinit of that class. Indeed, it does work, but it's not the most scalable, especially because if you want to have the same logic across several tests, then you need to not copy-paste code, but put the code into a function and then call that function into every initializer. So the first time I saw it, it's true that I got this feeling that it didn't felt super Swifty, or at least it didn't felt super aligned with the rest of the API of this framework. So it's nice to see that they made a change to offer something that appears much more aligned with the general philosophy of Swift testing. And it's also super interesting to see that because Swift testing is part of Swift and is actually also open source, then we get new features to Swift testing with the same release cycle than Swift. And so as we can see here, we don't necessarily need to wait 1 year for the next WWDC to get some new features for Swift testing. And finally, the last improvement highlighted by the Swift team is for Swift DocC, so the feature to generate a nice looking documentation for and from your Swift code, and it's about how to create links when you have several overloads of a same function. Up until now, the way that you would disambiguate if you wanted to create a link to one of these specific overloads was by appending a hash value at the end of the link, but this had the problem of not being human readable at all, and this has been fixed. Now you can disambiguate by still adding something at the end of the link, but this time you're adding something that is much more human readable, so easier to understand and also easier to fix if you've made a mistake. And that's it. These are the new features that the Swift team chose to highlight in their blog article to announce the release of Swift 6.1. As I said in the intro, if you want to try Swift 6.1, it's available in the latest version of Xcode, which is Xcode 16.3. If you've already been able to use some of these new features in your code, please let me know in the comments. And if there are other new features in Swift 6.1 that I failed to mention in this video, definitely please also tell me in the comments. As always, if you've enjoyed the video, please don't forget to leave a like and subscribe to my channel so that you don't miss the next ones. Thank you for watching and see you next time.